Hi, it's time now for our next talk. This talk is from Jakob Blume from CERN. He will be talking about the CERN VM for FS, giving us an overview of it and a roadmap for its future. Jakob, I'll hand over to you about 30 minutes for the talk, and then some time for questions.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's my first time at the EasyBuild users meeting, and I'm happy to tell you a bit about the CERN VM file system, what the system can do, and give you some ideas on what we plan to work on, let's say in the next year. So some words about the software distribution challenge. Then I would like to introduce the system and its main components, and specifically speak about containers and CERN VMFS. Containers obviously being one of the big important technologies for software distribution, and then a little bit of an outlook and a summary. So this picture shows the CERN VMFS deployment that we run for the LHC experiments for high energy physics. So in a nutshell, what CVMFS does is the delivery of scientific software, containers, and auxiliary data. I will speak a little bit about this later, what exactly we mean by auxiliary data, but let's say mainly scientific software and containers to a worldwide distributed network of loosely coupled data centers. This is what we run for high energy physics, which we call the GRID, so a federation of data centers. And what you can see are the server infrastructure, so data sources and mirror servers. These are about 10 of them. We call them stratums. So stratum zero is a data source, stratum one is a replica, is a mirror server. And then all the data centers that read software from those servers, and there we run about 400 caches, site caches, for efficient access. And so we have, or we are aware of more than a billion files that are under management, obviously serving high energy physics and the LHC experiments. But along the years, we have also attracted some other users. There's LIGO, gravitational waves, Euclid, the European space mission, and of course, EASY. And if I'm not mistaken, there's a talk tomorrow about EASY, the EASY project. So CERN VMFS is a file system. So if you have the CVMFS client installed on a Linux or a macOS machine, it provides a uniform, consistent, versioned POSIX file system access to this area / CVMFS. In this example, for the CMS experiment at the LHC, and you can see it spans the tree of all the different software versions that are built and available and that you might need on a machine to run CMS experiment software. Of course, you pick one of them. So at any given point in time, you only need one of those subdirectories. And that you can do on grids and clouds, on HPC systems, and also on the end user laptops. So that is for reading. But of course, someone also needs to write. And CVMFS, in contrast to many other file systems, is a highly asymmetric file system. So there are many readers, but only few writers, and we call them publishers. And typically, the publishers are software librarians. So this is a usually small team in a scientific collaboration that takes care of building the software stack and then writing it to CVMFS. Whatever is written there is cryptographically signed and it's written in a transactional manner. So on the file system, you will never see half a software version written, but you write all of your new software version, you commit and push, and then the clients atomically see the new version being available. And so there are only a few publishers. Typically you have like a dedicated place where you stage new content into the system. And we call this the stratum zero. Right. So why do it by a file system? Why do it by a global shared software area? Well, that part of the explanation is simply that the scientific software stack can be, at least in our case, it is quite large and complex. So that's, again, for the CMS experiment at the LHC, the typical software stack starting from the operating system and some base libraries, compilers. Then we have common high energy physics libraries, let's say for math, for machine learning, geometry, and so on. On top of that, there's an experiment specific framework. So every detector has its own software framework on top of it. And then comes individual analysis code from researchers at the very top. And all of this comprises the software release, where in our case, often hundreds of developers have contributed. This can span something like several tens of thousands or even 100,000 files per release. And this is for the production releases. For every production release, of course, if you look at nightly builds, you can produce much more because you test with different compilers, different combinations, platforms, and so on. So this is at the moment typically something like a terabyte per night of nightly builds. We distribute this to about 100,000 machines worldwide. And something that is a bit special about the scientific software is that the releases need to remain available. So it's not like you always update to the newest, but you want to be able to go back and do the same analysis with the software release that you used 3 years ago. Right, so, and if you look at common tools for sharing data center applications, they are all bundle or package based, right? We have obviously Docker, but then also more traditional packages like Windows Installer, let's say RPM, Debian packages, and so on. So the applications get bundled ahead of time and then installed everywhere. And that is an efficient way to structure the build process, but it is actually a quite inefficient way for the large scale rollout. And we see on the next slide why this is. So this is an example with R. So let's say I pull the Docker container for the R statistics toolkit. I get a gigabyte, approximately, a little bit less, a few hundred megabytes of image data. And then I use it to run something, let's say the fitting tutorial. And it turns out of my close to gigabyte of container image, I actually only have used 30 megabytes. This is what I would actually need. So what we would ideally want to have is a container for the isolation part, but for the distribution, it would make much more sense to have something that loads on demand, that loads only those 30 megabytes that I happen to need at any given, for any given job, for any given processing task. And I mean, especially in the HPC environment, we actually know about shared software areas. The problem often with this is if we put them on general purpose distributed file systems, it's very easy to break them. And the reason is the high metadata rate. Software typically consists of very many small files. And when we start a job in the data center or on the HPC system, all of the nodes want to access the same set of small files at the same time, open the same Python files to start TensorFlow. And we can easily have a megahertz request rate per compute node and a kilohertz file open rate. And that can bring down even powerful distributed file systems to their knees. Right, and so if you look a bit closer into, I mean, usually distributed file systems are optimized for data delivery. If we use them for software, we see very quickly that the specifications are very different and for some of the like typical metrics, many orders of magnitudes apart from each other. For instance, file sizes and access patterns. So software, if you look at it, from this point of view, is massive, but not in volume. In volume, it's very small, but in number of objects and in metadata rates. And that was the motivation to do a purpose-built file system for software delivery, which became CERN VMFS. And so it is purpose-built, and it works well for a specific set of, let's say, application areas. And these are the four application areas where it has proven to work well. That is production software, so a software stack for, let's say, a CMS experiment or Atlas experiment, what I showed before. Relatively stable software, stable repositories, and it is used by a large number of machines for data processing jobs. Then we have the integration builds. Integration builds are a little bit different. We publish much more because usually all different combinations and tests are being published, but we access it only from usually the developer machines or some test nodes. So the integration builds are really about publishing throughput much more than about read scalability. Then container images, I will speak about this a little bit later. So it's actually, so CVMFS is a good fit to deploy container images at scale. The only trick here is to distribute container images not as one big block or blob, but to unpack them, to explode them before into the file system, and then you can use them essentially like a chroot entry point. And lastly, what about data? There are some data sets that can be distributed very well on CVMFS. I call them auxiliary data sets. So that is not clearly defined. It's a type of data that goes well along with your software, that has a similar access pattern than your software. So an example is, for instance, what we call in high energy physics conditions data. That is the state of the particle detector at the time of data taking. And that's typically, let's say, what you need for a particular data processing task is a few gigabytes. And the important point is all the nodes in your data center need typically the same few gigabytes at any given point in time. And that is makes them different from the actual event data, from the actual physics data, where every node needs a different set of data files. And for the real data files, we have high throughput systems that are tuned for high volumes. But for the conditions data, CVMFS works quite well. Another example is from the bioinformatics community, genome reference data sets. Those go also well on CVMFS. So let's go a little bit into the components of the system. For reading, we have a Fuse file system client. This is what you see on the left side. So this is a single compute node, let's say, with a Linux and Fuse kernel module and the CVMFS Fuse client. All the data transfer in CVMFS is done by HTTP. So the content is available on an HTTP server, on S3 server. This is the stratum one typically. Then there is a hierarchy of web caches, and that is, you know, can be designed according to scalability needs. And at some point, files end up on the client. There's also a client cache, typically a few gigabytes, or let's say 10, 20 gigabytes in size. Right, and so especially those HTTP caches, let's say the site caches or data center caches, they are usually used very efficiently because typically the nodes in the cluster require the same bits at any given point in time. Availability is essentially everywhere where there is Fuse. We have a few A platforms and B platforms. A platforms, so the best tested platforms, are Enterprise Linux 7.8 at the moment, Ubuntu, the long-term releases, but it's also, we have it available for macOS, SUSE, Enterprise Linux, Fedora, Debian, then different architectures like ARM, Intel 32-bit, and even some experimental builds for Power, Raspberry Pi, and RISC-V. Now, so how does the publishing work? For the publishing, we look at the dedicated publisher node, so the node that maintains the Stratum Zero authoritative storage. And what we do in publishing is we use a union file system on that specific node, because so typically the CVMFS or the CVMFS client is read-only. So we cannot write anything, but we can put a union file system on top of it, so like a writable layer on top of it. And all the changes that we are then going to write into this virtual mount, in this virtual writable mount point, are ending up in the staging area. And this staging area we can then use to commit the new and modified files to the central storage. This can be either local file system attached to the node or S3 storage system. And in practice, this is how it works. On the machine that has that is a dedicated publisher, you open a transaction. At this point, then slash CVMFS container CVMFS.io, if this happens to be your repository name, becomes writable, so you can write some content, for instance, untar something, and publish it. And when the publish is finished, this is the point where the atomic commit has taken place. What happens during publishing? During publishing, we rewrite the file system, the content that you have written, into an internal format, into a content addressable storage. So CVMFS publish routine walks through the staging area, picks up all the changes, compresses the files, hashes them, and puts them into an object store. So that can be a location on your local file system or S3. And all the metadata, they end up in SQLite file catalogs. And SQLite databases are also plain files, so they can go into the object store as well. So the object store has simply compressed files and chunks, deduplicated. And the SQLite file catalogs keep track of the file system structure, like directory structure, symbolic links, the content hashes. They are digitally signed. They have a time to live. This is how clients get to know about updates. When the time to live expires, they will look if something new is there. And they use hash trees in order to, secure, let's say, the entire directory tree cryptographically, so that you know you don't get any garbage data by mistake, for instance. So that also means we can use untrusted intermediate storage systems, right? We can use HTTPS. We do not have to use, we can use HTTP. We don't have to use HTTPS. So the deduplication is actually quite useful. That is shown on the next slide. This is an example from one of our nightly build notes. And you see on the x-axis publish ID, so every point is a publish operation. And on the y-axis, you see how many files have been published in that operation. And so if you look at the upper part, this is a logarithmic scale. You see the number of processed files, so like number of files that were in your staging area. And in purple is the number of actually new files. So most of those files that that were published happen to be already in the repository under different path. And you see this is like a few percent of the files in the lower part. You see only a few percent of the files is new. And this is very typical for software. If we release version 53 and we have already versions 1 to 52 installed, it turns out not that many files are actually new. Right, so a little bit on the caching infrastructure, the transport. So I said that the content is on the Stratum 1 replica on a web server, and clients read it through HTTP, and typically they go through caches. And what we have seen is a site cache, a web cache, we use Squid, but you can use different technology as well, different caching servers. Typically, you have something like 500 nodes per cache. That is a ratio that works fine. it's for various reasons a good idea to have multiple caches on site, because the system is built in a way that the entire transport infrastructure is stateless. And so that means you can take out any part, you can take out caches, you can take out replica servers, and the clients will simply try different ways to get to the same content. So in this case, we have added 2 Squid servers, but this we have done for scalability. Let's say we have 1,000 nodes in the data center. Now one of them fails. So the client realizes, okay, this path is blocked. Let's try for a time being this other path. And the same we can do on the replica side, where clients pick using GeoIP a geographically close replica. But if that one fails, they can fail over to a different one. And one interesting point here, clients have a local cache, so they can run in completely disconnected mode. If they happen to have no cache misses, they can work, for instance, on a laptop on travel in disconnected mode. Also on an HPC site, if the cache is pre-populated, there's not necessarily outgoing network connectivity needed. So a little bit about containers and CVMFS. So for containers and CVMFS, we have to distinguish 2 different problems that we might want to solve. The problem on the left side is, let's say we have a container from somewhere, let's say an Ubuntu-based operating system, and we want to make a software tree in CVMFS available to that container. The easiest way is to bind mount from the host into the container. But if this is not possible, for instance, if, let's say, CVMFS is not available on the container host, we have a few more advanced options to make CVMFS available nevertheless. That can be that you mount inside the container. That works without any privileges if kernel and container runtime and everything else is new enough. We have also an option to let Singularity take a part of mounting CVMFS. I will show this later. Or CVMFS itself can come as a client container and expose the /CVMFS area to other containers. I will also speak this in a minute. So that's problem 1, provide CVMFS in an existing container. And problem number 2 that we might want to solve is, let's say I have a set of containers with all my software and I want to deploy them at scale. And here, what we have seen at least is that if you have enough machines, that can put quite some stress on the registry and on the worker node image caches. So it works quite well to distribute those containers instead of like Docker Hub from in an unpacked way from CVMFS. And to do this, well, we need to take the containers and publish them in CVMFS. We have a tool to do this. And we need to make sure that the container runtime actually can use those unpacked containers from CVMFS. So let's have a look into the first case. Let's say we have a container, BusyBox in this case, and we want to make CVMFS available. This we can do with a standard bind mount if CVMFS is available on the host. The important bit here is to use a shared one to make the entire subtree of /CVMFS available. Same with Singularity. Now, if I do not have CVMFS on the host, then there's a relatively new little utility called CVMFS exec that might help. And this is, it's a clever sandbox. So what you see here in this command is you call CVMFS exec, you tell it which repositories you would like to have available in your sandbox, and then you run the command. And in this case, I wanted to have Grid and Atlas, and they are available together with a helper repository. And if kernel and some other bits are new enough, that works completely unprivileged. Then what can be done is to deploy the client itself as a container. So what does it mean? We have the client in a container, we mount CVMFS inside that container, and then we leak it out to the host. And in practice, this is how it works. We call Docker run, we run it as a service container. We set a few options. We need a few privileges to do this. And we leak the / CVMFS volume, in this case, out from the container to the host. And on the host, we can then look into CVMFS, and there it is. So that is an interesting way to just try it out if you do not want to start immediately with a package installation. But it's actually interesting to target systems that do not have traditional package managers. For instance, let's say Atomic Host, so container-only operating systems. And it is the way to target Kubernetes clusters. So this container can be used and deployed as a Kubernetes daemon set and make CVMFS available to all the pods in your Kubernetes cluster. And the last point that might be relevant for HPC systems, specifically for HPC systems that already have Singularity installed. If this is the case, Singularity can take care of the elevated privileges. So what happens in this script down here is Singularity starts a container, and the container has the CVMFS client installed. However, it might not have the privileges to actually use it, but Singularity does. And this fuse mount option says, okay, Singularity, please help me get the necessary privileges to mount a fuse file system inside the container. So that might make it a bit more available to some HPC installations. Right, so that was the client part, how to make the CVMFS client available in various ways. But what about if we have containers and we want to distribute them using CVMFS? And well, the first thing that we have to do is we have to convert them into a CVMFS repository. And we have done this. We have two big repositories in the high energy physics community, unpack.cern.ch, singularity.opensciencegrid.org, where we have each a couple of hundred images available. And if you remember one of the earlier slides where I showed the experiment software stack, this is a very well-defined software environment. You have these software librarians that carefully pick bits and pieces. If we start making container deployment to CVMFS available, this broadens the range quite a bit. And wherever you have a container to do something, this can end up in CVMFS. This can be base operating systems. This can be some user code, explorative tools, machine learning, user analysis, and so on. And even something like volunteer computing containers, such as folding at home. Now, once you have the container image available in, say, unpack.cern.ch, you see on the bottom, this is how you use it. You call Singularity exec. You simply point it to the container name, and you run your program. So how does the conversion work? For the conversion, we have a service called duck, so daemon that converts images into CVMFS. And at the moment, this works in collaboration with a regular registry and with a wish list. With a wish list that you see on the left side. So you specify which images from your regular registry, let's say GitLab registry, you would like to see in your CVMFS repository. And the daemon takes care of fetching the images, extracting them, publishing them on CVMFS. And if you look into the repository, what ends up in CVMFS unpack.cern.ch, you see what we have seen before. So the name of the container image so that you can for instance, started with singularity. And this points to the fully flattened container image. So this is like a ch-root starting point. But we also keep all the layers in its in their exploded form. So we can use it with singularity, but we can also use it with containerd, Kubernetes, Podman, and so on. So this is like our first incarnation, the wish list. We have seen that it might be nicer to actually automatically convert images when users push, so that they don't even need to think about the wish list. And this is what we plan for this year, a webhook connection, so that when you, let's say you have a Harbor registry or some other registry that can send a webhook whenever you push an image, and it will automatically trigger the image conversion. These are the runtimes that are supported, Singularity, natively also Podman. For Podman, we produce a little bit of extra metadata so that Podman can see the content in CVMFS and then use the images from there. For Docker and for Containerd, these are runtimes where we need plugins. We have one for Docker, and we have particularly one for Containerd, which is called a remote snapshotter. So that is how these plugins are called in Containerd. And we hope actually that Docker at some point would update to a recent enough Containerd foundation so that we can use this universally to target Docker, Containerd, and Kubernetes. Right, and this is an example what we have done with it at some point during the year. People in the distributed computing groups of the LHC experiments thought it might be a good idea to run folding at home. And this was the container was put in CVMFS and then ran on the LHC computing grid. And actually it put us right pretty much to the front of the teams. And we were in illustrious company of NVIDIA and Amazon and a few other big companies. So what are we planning to work on this year? Well, so I spoke about the publisher node and the fact that the publisher node is typically, or in a simple configuration, a single machine. Now, this single dedicated node obviously comes with drawbacks. It's a single point of failure, and it's also a performance bottleneck. Potentially. So one of the relatively new things that we have is the system for distributed publishing. And in this system, you can have multiple publisher nodes. You have to somehow orchestrate access to the central storage. And that is done through a gateway service. So the gateway service takes care of handing out leases or locks for certain parts of your directory tree. So that, for instance, your one builder node can write into /arm for all the ARM releases, and your second builder node at the same time writes into /x86-64 for your Intel releases. This works at a few repositories at the moment at CERN in production. And what we will do this year is work a bit on stabilization. We still have a set of known issues that need to be addressed, and also to match the feature set. Still, this distributed publishing cannot do exactly everything that the local publisher can do. For instance, you cannot trigger garbage collection from the remote publishers. So that's one area of work. The other one is is getting a bit experience with a new command that we have recently introduced, CVMFS server enter, it is called. And the idea of this command is that, well, maybe you would like to be able to get a writable /CVMFS area, not only on the publisher node, but on any machine that can mount the client. And this is exactly what the CVMFS server enter command can do. It requires, again, a relatively recent Linux kernel and Fuse overlay FS. But with these ingredients, any machine that can run a client can enter this enter subshell. You see this at the bottom. So you call, let's say, hsf.cvmfs.io. as a repository name, and it opens a shell where out of a sudden you have write access to this area and you can make modifications. Now, why is this a good idea? Well, for instance, if you have a build node that produces software that ends up in CVMFS, you can now build directly into /CVMFS. You don't need to build into some offsite area. And you can look at the changes. And that is what we want to work on. Of course, you would ideally like to directly publish from there. And we know how it works, but we have to implement it to connect this to the gateway publisher. And then you would be able to, given some access keys, to use any build node to push new releases into CVMFS. Right, so CVMFS is a special purpose virtual file system that provides a global shared software area for scientific collaborations. It uses content address storage, asynchronous writing, and those are the key ingredients to keep it scalable for a very large number of readers, so scalable on the reading side. And we work on container integration this year and next month, and scaling up the number of writers. And here's how you can find us, the website. You can find us on GitHub. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for the talk, Jakob. I know Kenneth's got a question, so we'll go to him first.
Yes. So the question I had is if you can elaborate a bit on the problems you've seen with getting HPC sites to adopt to making CVMFS repositories available on their systems, and
right.
what kind of concerns are raised typically, and if they are valid.
Right. So I'm probably the wrong person to say if they are valid or not, but the concerns that are typically raised are so. Typical problems is first the outgoing network connectivity. So the system works best if you use this setup of tiered caches. And this is, let's say, the zero configuration mode of running it. If the outgoing network connectivity is missing, you need to pre-stage files into the HPC site, preload the cache. We have tools for this, but it is some extra work. The second issue is deploying a Fuse client on the compute nodes. That has been a problem on some sites, not all. There are also many sites that install the Fuse client, for instance, CSCS, but there are also many others. But this can be a problem. And here, let's say there are several levels of how deep you want to install the client on the compute nodes. Of course, like the easiest or the fastest is to simply do yum install. But maybe that is not wanted for one reason or another. And in these cases, you can bring in, for instance, the client on demand with your Slurm, with the Slurm scheduler. If a job requires CVMFS, you could only then mount it on the node and unmount it when the client leaves. So there are some deployment options that we have developed over the years to make it a bit easier for HPC sites. Maybe one more point I should mention is the caching. An important piece of the caching infrastructure is the local compute node cache. Now, some HPC sites do not have that. There is simply no local disks on the compute node. And that also requires special configuration where, for instance, the bulk of the cache is on the cluster file system and then an upper cache layer sits in RAM. We have something which is called a tiered cache configuration that makes this possible. Or you have cache files per compute node where you loop back, mount them in a loopback mode to your compute nodes. All of this is not, I think there are no showstoppers, but they require special care and special configuration.
Okay, yeah, that's very clear. Thank you.
there are any more questions for Jakob, then raise your hand and we can allow you to ask the questions.
Hey, Jakob, maybe I have a question. So when the cache is being populated, so in this HPC user mode, when the cache is being populated, there was quite a bit of load I saw from CVS at that time. Now, it disappears, right, once the cache is populated. But then it made me wonder about the jitter. Does CVMS introduce jitter into the jobs? So would you be sacrificing scalability a little bit if you had the CVMS client?
We don't do this ourselves. So we would rely on the job scheduler for this. But the jitter is actually interesting, I think, only when you start using the software, when you read it, right? When you populate the cache, it should take a long time the first time for the initial population, but then subsequent calls only transfer the delta.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I hope this answers your question.
Yeah, no, I'm just curious like I say, I was looking at the cache loading up and I could see the load is like not small, right? Mm-hmm.
I have a question concerning the amount of Linux distributions that you have to maintain. So did you guys already consider to do something related like the Compute Canada DAS or like Easy Project DAS that are going to have like a compatibility layer so you can have a unique set of files that can run everywhere? Or are you going to always be adding newer versions of distributions and, you know, maybe?
Yeah, that is a good question. So the service container, the container that wraps around the client, is meant to use our fallback for any Linux that is not supported. That is our compatibility layer. Otherwise, I think being a file system, we are one of the pieces, software pieces that need to have distribution specific packages. And I think we will have to live with it and support what makes sense, what is actually being used by our users.
Hi. So my question would be, over the last year, we set up a CERN tier 2 site, actually. Mm-hmm. So we are running CVMFS on the compute nodes, or we run it on all the compute nodes, but we actually use it just on a partition. Mm-hmm. Still, my question would be, can I mix different upstream stratums then, basically? Because I would still want to go upstream to the CERN CVMFS stratum 1.0. But what's interesting from your presentation is definitely also the kind of small-ish static data sets, because we also have biologists, or we are actually mostly biologists that run on our machine. So this kind of reference genome data, stuff like that, might be something interesting. So I'm wondering, can you point it to different routes in that sense?
Right. Yes. So technically, all those mount points, all those repositories are completely independent. So your repository atlas.cern.ch could point to a completely mm-hmm. different stratum one than cms.cern.ch. What we do for the CVMFS configuration, it's typically grouped by domain, so that you would have mm-hmm. a domain configuration for .cern.ch. Mm-hmm. But if mm-hmm. you use, I don't know, bioinformatics.eu, you might go to a different set of servers.
All right, so that would, yeah. I see, that would then basically also differentiate basically for the CERN part to go to the Frontier Squid and whatever other proxy cache I have for other domains.
Yes, absolutely. So you can decide mm-hmm. whether mm-hmm. you want to share those caches. You can actually mm-hmm. safely share them mm-hmm. Or not.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Hi. So my question is easy. I'm used to using AFS. I think I see a little bit of influence here. So our scenario is that we have had a number of our file servers experience exactly what you described at the beginning. People started 150 MATLAB jobs on 150 separate nodes, and then they all went to the same NFS file server, which screamed and ran away from the data center. So what we are, our use case really is looking at things like Python distributions, R distributions, MATLAB distributions for the software that we know has got hundreds of thousands of files. And so I just wanted to make absolutely clear, we can, when a compute node boots up and is getting ready to be put into the scheduler and ready for jobs, we can ask it to pre-cache those applications so that those are already on the local disk at the point at which the compute node becomes available for other people's jobs.
Right, there is a tool which is called CVMFS preload, which can be used to preload part of the directory tree to the compute node. Now, typically, I would say this is not even necessary. You might have a different use case, but what we have seen in high energy physics, I think none of the production sites do it. It is true that the first time you run a job, it takes a bit longer to load all those Python libraries, but the local cache on the compute node is persistent. And so next time you run this software version or a similar one, it's as good as being preloaded.
Yeah, we have some, I think, I consider them to be a bit overeager system administrators. And so they like to reinstall compute nodes on a regular basis. So it would be nice to be able to preload immediately after reinstallation and before we give it to the users. So this was also kind of directed at the previous question about, does it introduce jitter to the nodes? And I think some of the, if you can identify the software that's going to be the biggest drag for populating the cache in the first place, if you pre-populate those, then you reduce that. So thank you.
Looks like we've finished with questions at that point. I can't see any more hands up. So again, thanks to Jakob. We will have break for a few minutes, and then just over 10 minutes time, we'll have our final talk of the day.
Thank you.